Tuesday, September 11th, 2001. Homeroom.
6 a.m.
Late.
Too early.
Late.
6:15. Wake up! Second day of school.
6:25.
Wake up! It's time to get up.
6:35.
You're gonna be late.
6:45.
It's about time. What do you want for lunch?
I'm so tired. I don't even want to go to school.
Falling asleep in the shower.
I blow dry my hair and put on my makeup.
Exhausted. Wear yesterday's clothes.
I look cute and can't wait to see my friends.
I'm mad there's a dress code, so I thought about wearing a t-shirt with grapes on the bust and the words gently squeezed by loving hands.
Nah.
Shredded wheat socks.
Blueberry yogurt. Whole wheat toast with strawberry jam.
Doritos or cheese nibs?
You're gonna catch a chill. You can take a shower and then stand by the bus stop. How will I catch a chill when I'm on fire?
I stay up late, so I wake up late. Don't have time to bathe. Gulp down coffee on the way to school. I don't spend enough time with the kids. Have to hear about them secondhand. Note to self, play with the kids.
My neighbor's son comes peeling out of the driveway with rap music blaring. Teenagers! It's 7 a.m.
I ride my bike to school, thinking it's cold and how dumb it is riding my bike.
I ride the bus as usual, listening to the middle schooler scream as usual.
I'm getting sneered at because I'm a freshman.
Thinking insignificant little thoughts about my insignificant little life.
Are these jeans too tight?
Have your lunch, honey.
Who's going to be in my study hall?
Can I really find all my glasses?
Hi-ya! Lift that leg again! Billy Blank flashing a toothy grin from across the TV screen.
Do I have to?
Shoo! Get out of my yard!
A regular day. Everybody saying hey. New people, as usual, having their sarcastic comments. This is gonna be a really hard year. Some of my teachers really suck. There's no one in my lunch.
I just wanna go to sleep.
Don't want winter to come and feel so empty.
First day of gym class. Gotta kick ass.
English.
Chemistry?
Health. Not study hall.
Yeah.
Ceramics?
I'm sitting in the auditorium thinking how lame.
Third period prep. I walk off into the woods for a smoke. Commune with nature. Solitude from the swarm. On my way back to my classroom, I pass the study hall. I overhear the sound of a radio. I think, wow, must be a pretty chill study hall. Teacher lets me listen to the radio.
Two teachers are talking. They sound scary.
Spanish class. Here's something about New York City. Some kind of plane crash?
A plane crash? That doesn't sound too bad.
My friend mutters something about 747 flying into buildings.
Tell us what's going on!
Good afternoon, students. Today is a great day, so if you are in need of assistance for mental health, we want you to know that we're here for you.
The whole world outside Rondout could blow up and we'd never know.
First period, social studies.
My mom was outside waiting for me. I was like,
turned on CNN.
NPR.
CBS.
The plane crashing into the building over and over again in endless reruns.
People chased by a huge cloud of smoke and debris.
A somber 5-year-old boy clutching a fireman's hat half his size.
This woman still covered with dust talking about how she saw a woman with her baby just being trampled. At that point, all my emotions came flowing out like a river. I just cried and cried, and then I was angry and confused and just about every other emotion you could possibly feel.
We all sat down the rest of the night and watched TV. When we ate dinner, we left it on to see if anything else would happen.
Forget homework. Homework. Notes for English. Today is Tuesday, named for the Norse god of war.
When I got home, my parents were screaming at me, so I walked out.
My father said that we as a country had brought this upon ourselves. And I agree.
My mother and I cried when we saw people sing Land of Liberty.
God bless America.
Well, of course I cried.
Angry at myself for crying. Feeling unjustified. Because I heard from my dad, and that was my main concern. An email. Hi, I'm okay. Love, Dad. Well, this is simply far too real. I can't accept the simplicity of it.
I cried until it hurt.
I felt nothing. Everything. I'm terrified every time someone overly notices my brown skin, afraid of their anger.
Afraid?
I felt very sad, and I can't explain why. There aren't enough words in the world to explain what my heart felt in that moment.
That night, the house was quiet, everyone thinking and very sad.
Thinking Alia had just died, that woman got hit from the bus to work.
I can't decide if I'm more nervous with my door open or shut.
I'm one of those people that believe in the saying, don't think of it as a loss. Think of this person as one more angel in heaven.
Bad people, war, bombs, war.
My mother wouldn't stop complaining that me and my brother didn't understand the magnitude of what happened. Ever since the TV's been on, it's like she's been obsessed.
My life is still unimportant compared to those who don't have one anymore.
I puked.
I was scared. I took the dog outside and saw two planes in the sky. The guy next door told me it was okay, that they were supposed to be there.
Am I safe? I heard someone was talking about beating me up at school.
My mom said she doesn't want me to go back to school tomorrow. But I said, Mom, I'm not gonna hide in fear of these people. I'm going to school tomorrow.
Food. Always comforting. Carbos and fat, macaroni and cheese.
I didn't need comfort. I didn't want comfort. There was a candlelight vigil at the rec center. I went to the movies instead.
I am certain that Pakistan Center will not hold and will destabilize and be overrun by Islamic fanatics who will wield the nuclear bomb as a catalyst for World War III, thus fulfilling Nostradamus' prediction of the third Antichrist coming out of the Middle East. This frightens me.
I am unaffected, yet sadly comfortable.
When I went to my room, I put on my favorite song to cheer me up. It's the song The Immigrant by The Prodigals. I only sing one part of the song because it means something to me. It goes, "You can drink till you're dry. You can laugh till you cry. But the tears in your eyes keep from falling." I love that part. And when I went to bed, I hoped that everything would be the same tomorrow. It wasn't.
Second period, accounting.
I lost a friend in New York that day, but not in the way most would think. He was talking to me over the net that evening, and he said all Arabs were stupid, so I told him what a total moron he was and told him to go to hell. We haven't talked since.
At around 8:30, I called one of my friends. I was like, "Hey man, are you okay?"
"Yeah, dude, I'm fine."
"Man, I'm sick to death of all this death and destruction."
"I know, me too."
"We were down in the city just a week ago. We ate at an Indian place on 6th Street. I took the subway to Battery Park for a sunset ride on the Staten Island Ferry. asked me to take the elevator up with them to the observation deck.
Please, Mommy, please!
Not today, sweetie.
So many people. Who
were they?
Brother Jake. He's in DC. He asked if Paul's in the city. Yeah, he and me in this morning. He wants to know where. I don't know. Am I supposed to be your brother's keeper? Is the meeting at the Trade Center? I don't know, maybe. Turn on my TV. I do. Billy knits slowly and reluctantly watching dissolve into a smoking tower. Voices are saying things, words, but I don't hear them. My stomach goes hollow. My legs give out. I'll call you back. Call the cell phone, punching the numbers, messing up. Punch again, and again, recorded message about busy circuits. Paul's office. I don't know the number by heart. Find it, his freaking business card. I keep glancing at the screen, disbelief, horror. Another plane plows into Tower 2. Fear, my life, my family. Too much death already, mama, my brother, my sister's cancer. Not my husband, too. Please, God, not that. The phone. Someone's talking. It's Eric in the office. Hey, I don't think he's there, but I got a crew on the 103rd floor in Tower 1. I got him on walkie. They're stuck in the stairwell, no way down. One guy made it to the roof. Nothing there. Am I saying the right things? I don't know what to do. I'm thinking, Jesus, Eric, I'm having my own damn crisis here. But instead, I say, you're doing great, Eric. Just stay calm. They need you to stay calm. It's 9:30 a.m. I hang up. I call the cell. Now intimate with a series of tones, the annoying sameness of the message. I call the office. Eric? But before I can say anything, he's launched into it. I lost them. They were crying. It was too hot. The line went dead. I think they jumped. It's 9:45, and my panic level is at an all-time high. I've reached target heart rate without even one billy kick. Eric, are you okay? No, he says. I'm not. Go home, I tell him. Go home and kiss your son. The towers have collapsed. How many people were still in there and on the planes? Where is my freaking husband? If he's not dead already, I'm gonna kill him for not calling. It's 10 a.m. Where is he? I'm punching the air in pure frustration. The phone. Hello? I'm trying to ring in the stairs.
third period, creative writing, somewhere in Hollywood.
Machine guns blazing, carrying stranded victims out to safety. Something like Die Hard 9, 10, or whatever it is now. Lost track. What have you got for me?
Goal 4-2, Operation Infinite Justice.
No.
Okay. Enduring Freedom.
Better.
Come on, it's gonna be great! Just like Goal 4 Operation Desert Storm. Same plot points, same themes, same characters, same ending. Well, we hope.
Tell me more.
The hero. The hero. Literally George Bush, too. Same politics, same advisors, same name, same charming accent, but
you
catchphrases. Like, this is a war between freedom and fear.
Oh, man, I love it.
The villain. Oh, Osama bin Laden. He's Saddam Hussein 2. Hitler 3, but he's worse than Hitler.
Isn't that the same tagline we used last time?
See, Osama's just like Saddam. Powerful, cruel, intelligent, sneaky. He doesn't like us, but people like him. We armed Saddam, and we made Osama. The CIA trained him to fight the USSR.
Okay, hold on. Massive plot holes here. The biggest one being, why do they hate us?
They hate freedom.
Please, no complex answers that have us look into ourselves or our foreign policy. Not in an action movie. Oil.
We'd be building a pipeline through Afghanistan if they didn't hate us.
Collateral damage?
Oh yeah, plenty. Civilians get killed while the bad guys hide in bunkers, caves, and palaces. Oops, we all make mistakes, but our intentions are good.
The Gulf War. It was cool, wasn't it? Like a video game. Think of the licensing ops, man. Great visuals. Violent. Though sanitized.
Right. We don't see the villagers getting killed. The desperate people stepping on landmines in attempts to reach the food we drop. Or the rations landing on people since we don't attach parachutes to them.
Oh, man. Every movie needs comic relief.
What we do see are big, cool explosions. We win. We go in, we blow a bunch of stuff up, and then we get out with just a few smudges.
But so did Saddam.
And so bin Laden.
We'll bring them both back for Gulf War 3. Operation God is on our side.
Fourth period, U.S. history.
Republic for which it stands, flag in the street, yelling, "Allah! Allah!" While people got out of their cars and beat him to the ground.
He deserved it.
With liberty and justice for all.
When we started bombing Afghanistan, I was glad we were doing something.
Some people, my dad for example, thinks war is the only and best solution. I don't want to believe that.
Dude, America's so screwed up right now. I can't believe we're bombing.
Bomb them all.
Now we're terrorists too.
Blow them off a piece of the earth.
We're just asking for more. I've never had so many nightmares in my life as I've had this past month, worried for my family.
Nuka!
It isn't worth killing civilians to make us look strong.
I have no opinion.
Have you noticed how much less news coverage there is of us bombing them?
The crater formerly known as Afghanistan.
Ashganistan.
I mostly don't talk about it. It's all in my head.
I'm glad we're bombing. I think...
I don't want to get drafted.
Fifth period, foreign language.
In the streets of Nablus.
Little children throwing candy in the streets.
People chanting,
God is good.
They're Muslim.
Why did they hate us so much? The women of Afghanistan.
Buried alive in mass graves.
Raped teenagers.
Flies inside diseased homes.
It's illegal to smile in public.
Women killed for exposing a wrist.
We should just bomb them all.
Maybe I shouldn't smile.
I heard the gas station guy was arrested.
Hey man, you're making money off the American dream. We deserve it.
I buy American gas. I'm scared for my family.
Scared.
Biological warfare. Anthrax.
I mean, I've planned stuff for my life. I really don't want to get some stupid disease and die before I have a chance to do anything.
I hate not knowing.
I heard there was a bomb on the Midlands and Bridge.
A bomb threat.
Whatever.
Scary stuff. Everybody's so paranoid, and I guess they have some right to be.
Timothy McVeigh was a typical American boy. And look what he did.
Anyone can be a terrorist.
Timothy McVeigh. So now do we beat up all skinny white people?
Like you?
The reservoir. The orange plastic cones look so flimsy.
Our water.
Right where our children ride their bicycles.
It's 11 a.m. and I'm still in my PJs. I've got work I'm supposed to be doing. I don't sleep anymore. I'm in the vanguard of the freaked out. So the other night I'm down at Emmanuel's buying shrimp for dinner and the guy over the counter is saying that the Citgo in town is shut down. And five other Pakistan-run gas and convenience stores in Chokan, Rosedale, Ellenville. Why? so the FBI can investigate links to the Taliban. The fish guy goes off on a racist rant and I walk away with my jaw dropped. Then I drive to the Citgo and it is closed. And I think the world as I know it is over. I live in this safe little haven. I don't lock my door. I leave my keys in my car overnight, and now that's all over. It's here in my yard. I mean, let's say Osama bin Laden is buying up gas in convenience stores all around the New York City water supply. They're drivable bombs. You get a gas truck in your station, hit the guy over the back of the head, you can blow it up, ram it into the reservoir, poison our water. And these guys in those stations, they're not friendly. They're not even neutral. They are actively hostile. I mean, they're not like the Greek or Korean grocery store owners. These guys don't want to fit in. And they're all men. Where are the women? Is this racist talk up? If so, how dare I? My grandmother was in Auschwitz. How dare I? On the other hand, if this is true, and this is the reason I can't get out of bed in the morning, if this is terrorism, then it works. I'm terrified.
Sixth period, modified math.
Okay, so you know how the date of the attack is 911, right? Like the emergency number? How weird is that?
And it's all 11s. 9 plus 1 plus 1 equals 11. And September 11th is the 254th day of the year. 2 plus 5 plus 4 equals 11. And the first plane hit the towers, flight 11. And flight 11, 92 passengers on board. 9 plus 2 equals 11. And New York City was the 11th state to join the Union. And in New York City, 11 letters. Afghanistan, 11 letters. The Pentagon, 11 letters.
Whoa, dude. My name has 11 letters. How scared should I be? Terrorists are after me. I'm going into hiding like now. There's gotta be some place on planet Earth I can hide. Whoa. Planet Earth also has 11 letters. Maybe Nostradamus can help me out. Yeah, Nostradamus. Wait. Nostradamus also has 11 letters. The Red Cross, T-H-E-R-E-C-R-O-S, 11 letters. Somebody help me, send me email. Wait, don't send me email. Send me email also has 11 letters. Will this never end? Am I going insane? Wait, I'm going insane, 11 letters. No!
How many letters in Rondout High?
11!
Seventh period, music in our lives.
I read this last night on the internet. A letter from a Juilliard student. Monday, September 17th. Yesterday, I had the most bully experience of my life. Juilliard organized cortes to go plant the armory is a large military building where families of missing people from Tuesday's disasters go and wait to hear from their loved ones. A whole building, the size of a city block, was covered in missing posters. Thousands of posters, each spread out to 8 feet from above the ground, each featuring a different smiling face. I made my way into a large central room and met up with my Juilliard buddies. For 2 hours, we cyber-read quartets with only 3 people. I'll never forget the grief counselor from the Connecticut State Police who listened the whole time. Or the woman who only listened to Memory from Cats, crying the whole time. At 7, the 2 other players had to go. They've been playing since 1 and couldn't go on. So I volunteered to stay and play solo. A man of fatigue, who introduced himself as Sergeant Major, asked if I'd mind playing for his soldiers as I returned from digging up the rubble at Ground Zero. Masseuses volunteered to give the men massages, and he didn't think anything would be more soothing than listening to violin music and getting massages. So for the next 4 hours, I played everything I could from Memory. Soga Tips, Prelude, Silent Night, My Country, Tis of Thee, and Scarborough's Fair. I've never played before a more grateful audience. By the end, my annotation was shot. I had no bow control. I would have lost any competition I was playing. It didn't matter. The soldiers would come up the stairs in full gear, take off their helmets, look at me, and smile. At 11:20, I was introduced to the Colonel Slack, the head of the division. After thanking me, he said, "Boy, today was the toughest yet. I made the mistake of going back to the pit. I'll never do that again." Eager to hear a firsthand account, I asked, "What did you see?" He stopped, swallowed hard, and said, "What do you expect to see?" The Colonel stood as I played a lengthy rendition of Amazing Grace, which he claimed was the best he ever heard. I didn't think I could play anymore. I asked the Surgeon Major if it would be appropriate if I played the National Anthem. He shouted above the chaos of the milling soldiers, of the 300 milling soldiers of the 69th Division as they saluted an invisible flag. As I rode the taxi back to Juilliard, free of course, since taxi service in New York is free right now, I was numb. Not only was it was the proudest I've ever felt to be an American, it was the most meaningful as a musician and a person as well. At school, kids are so hypercritical of each other and very competitive. Teachers expect technical perfection, but this wasn't about that. The soldiers didn't care that I had so many memory slips that I lost count. I never understood fully what it means to communicate music to other people. Now I'll never forget when I asked the colonel to describe the pit, and he couldn't. Words only go so far, and music can only go a little bit further from there.
Eighth period, Global Studies. Thank you.
I was born 2 years and 4 months after 9/11.
I was born about 3 years after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 3 months after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 8 months after 9/11.
I was born 1 year and 8 months after 9/11.
I was born 1 year and 11 months after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and a month.
I was born 2 years and 1 month after 9/11.
I was born 3 years and 5 days after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 5 months after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 10 months after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 2 months after 9/11.
I was born 2 years and 9 months after 9/11.
I was born 3 years and 8 months after
9/11. Kaz decided to choose this show because none of us were alive during 9/11, but still, it changed all of our lives. Now, if you would like to, please share your stories of where you were during 9/11.
I was in LA. I moved from New York 4 years before 9/11. We're from New York, so we spent our whole morning trying to find where people were and like what was happening in the show. And we knew people who worked in the buildings, we knew people who worked in the buildings next to the buildings. And we pretty much, by the afternoon, got a hold or found out where everybody was. And my biggest memory is when I was in my bathroom and I got a call from my childhood friend, who I've been friends with since first grade. And he said, Timor's missing. And I said, what do you mean missing? Where does he work? I don't understand. I'm like, And he said he worked in the towers on the 93rd floor. And being 3,000 miles away and being an artist like all of you, I was like, well, we're gonna find him. And you're gonna find him and tell his parents to post his picture and you're gonna find him. You're gonna find him. And he's like, Marn, you just need to accept that we might not find him. Did not believe it. And I got in the shower and I cried and I prayed. And I never found him. So I came tonight because some of the kids I've known since you're little, but also because it's the first time I've ever been able to watch something on 9/11. So thank you for doing this. And
early riser, and it's the first time I ever
people at a job I had. So after watching the news and watching all of it, we, a girlfriend and I, drove to the Twin Towers in Los Angeles and we're calling everybody, don't come to work, don't come to work, don't come to work, don't come to work, stay home, take care of your family, watch TV. And we were 3,000 miles away and it impacted us so much.
I just want to thank you guys for doing this, as Marnie said. It was so important for those of us who were around at that time, knowing that you kids really were not as aware of it as we were. And it's an amazingly powerful moment for all of us. You guys were fabulous.
Please meet the actors in the hallway.